In round 3 in Berlin, we played against the team of Solingen. Solingen is a pretty strong team, but despite that, we actually managed to put up a very good fight, only losing the match with a score of 3-5 in the end. And maybe on some boards, even half a point more would have been possible, but of course, also half a point less. So I played against the Austrian number one, Markus Rager, who would currently also be the number one in the German ranking. So a very, very strong player and a very principled player. So I know that he always goes for the actual main lines. And so I was not surprised to see him play e4 against me because, yeah, this is a point of my repertoire where I don't go for the main lines usually, but deviate quite early. And he was hoping for an opening advantage in this way. So I was considering to play knight c6 against him, but I thought this is going to be too much theory and I will not be able to prepare that in such a short amount of time before the game. So I was just playing d6 and the Philidor Antoshin, which I played quite often already. Well, after the normal moves of this line, he came up with the absolute main line, namely the move bishop to f4. The other main line is g3, so I spent most of my time preparing for these two lines. Yeah, last year against Zuling, I lost a game in that very line against Erwin Lamy, where I now played the move d5, and then he came up with a move long castles. After d5, there are also some other critical lines, like knight db5, and I was pretty sure that Markus is very well prepared for these lines, so I decided to go for something else. And that something else is the move knight to c6. It's actually a move which I think also in my book gave as playable, but which leads to a small advantage for white. And in fact, the fact that I played it is mainly due to the following sequence, namely takes takes. And now in the book, I think I mainly analyzed the move bishop to e6. Actually Rudolf Mason, one of my comrades in the team, suggested the move a6 to me. And indeed, this a6 leads to pretty interesting play. So in most of the games, white now played some move like f3 or bishop to e2. Yeah, and then black gets the typical Philidor counterplay in these lines where white castles long with b5 and maybe later c5, b4, queen a5, bishop e6, and so on. So it's pretty easy to play that position for black. So basically a6 has the advantage of being one move quicker in these lines compared to bishop e6, where white is then one move quicker on the king side. Yet the downside of a6 is what Markus played in the game, and this has not been played very much. And this is the move e5. So this directly releases the tension in the center, but the problem is that white has a lot of advantage in terms of development and space. So I just took, and the following line is pretty much forced. Now he puts a lot of pressure on the d-file, so I have to take the bishop with check. And now again, my queen is attacked, so I have to remove it. And up to here, basically, the line is forced. So here he started thinking, and I was actually still in my preparation. There were no over-the-board games for this position, but there were a few correspondence games which I had found in which black quite comfortably held his own. So Markus was now starting to think, and so mainly there are two options, bishop to c4 and bishop to d3. And he started calculating the move bishop to d3, which has not been played in these correspondence games, but which is a pretty tricky move. If I just develop normally with a move like bishop e6, he could go queen to h4, now threatening bishop takes h7, because I can't take back with a knight due to my queen be hanging on e7. So for that reason, I would probably have to go rook fe8, defending the queen, and now after a move like maybe even rook he1, he keeps more pieces on the board, and it's slightly awkward with this h7. After, let's say, queen c5, it's probably not too bad, but white has a small edge. So this would definitely have been unpleasant. So after bishop d3, I actually should aim for a more precise move order, and this is the move rook to e8, preventing rook he1. Yeah, and so basically now if he goes for something like queen h4, I can probably just go h6. And still he can't go rook h1 because I can just always take the two rooks for the queen. And then I will get a similar position like the aforementioned ones, but probably this is slightly more precise in terms of move order because I can then play bishop e6 and rook d8 or queen c5 in one go. So this position should also be around equal. Yeah, maybe I can also go queen c5 first. Well, instead, he went for the move that was also played in the correspondence games, the move bishop to c4. Very logical, preparing rook h to e1. And yeah, at first glance, it might look like black is doing fine because I have no weaknesses in terms of pawn structure, but he has this small lead in development, which is a little bit unpleasant. For that reason, I now exchange this disadvantage in terms of development against a disadvantage in terms of pawn structure by playing the move bishop to e6. So he just pins me, and now it's clear that whenever he takes on e6, I have to take back with the f pawn, leaving me with three pawn islands against just two. Rook a d8, and now he just took on e6, and I took back. Yeah, in the aforementioned correspondence games, white now took on d8 and later on came with something like knight e4 and then tried to get some play against the king. But also there, black managed to hold quite comfortably. So I think in just from a theoretical point of view, this position should be holdable. But the question when I was preparing for it was, so how bad is this going to be if you play against a very strong player like Markus Raga? And so I played around a bit and had the feeling that this is okay. Yeah, so it's a slight disadvantage because of this slightly weakened pawn structure, but it should be fine. Well, he now understandably didn't want to trade more pieces, but instead played the move queen to c4, after which I was also out of book. Yeah, so now this puts some pressure along this diagonal and has a pretty interesting plan. So the main problem that white has in the position is the knight on c3. So if this knight was instead on e5, the position would be very clearly better for white. But the knight on c3 can't do that much. So strategically, what can white do with the knight? Well, he could either exchange it on e4, but then of course by exchanging you again reduce the number of pieces, which means that you have fewer winning chances. Or you can do what Markus did, playing queen c4, keeping the rooks on the board, and now sometimes threatening to take on d8. So basically this forces me now to take on d1, but he can just take back with the knight. Very interesting, now aiming for a route via e3. Black has different ways of dealing with it, so I could also play rook to e8 in this position, which is, I think, also perfectly fine, but I just played king to f7 because I thought my king is quite safe on f7, and my plan will just be to go rook d8, queen d7 next, and then to annoy him on the d-file, which then either forces even more exchanges, or I could aim for some counterplay with queen d2. He went for the logical knight e3. Computer even gives some strange move in this position, b5 immediately, with this very strange idea of going queen d6, hunting for this pawn. Not sure if this is the most human way of playing. In any case, I did not really consider going after that little pawn on h2. Instead, I went for the move rook to d8, which looks a little bit more human, I would say. And my opponent now retreated on his own. Still, the main topic of the position is the knight on e3. Also, this knight currently has absolutely no squares. Note that if you jump to f5 here, it's always blocked by queen d7, threatening queen d2, and eventually maybe also e takes f or just queen to d5. So that's not really a threat at this point. Okay, he goes for queen e2. Again, trying to get this knight into the game. If the knight lands on e5, as we have discussed before, this is pretty advantageous for white. So his idea is now to pick this route to bring the knight to e5. So this also makes it pretty logical what I should do, namely a prophylactic move b5 to prevent knight c4. With the idea that whenever he goes knight to g4, I can just take. And after some move like rook to d5, I have even some counterplay on the d-file, maybe sometimes the threat of just exchanging queens, and slightly more active king even, so I don't think that I'm even a tiny bit worse here, so I think it's just equal. For that reason, my opponent now took very concrete measures. So he played a move which I had not really seen coming, or at least not at all in combined with the idea that he had, which was to bring the knight to e5. So maybe you can think about a move for white which poses the threat of bringing the knight to e5. Well, the move is knight to f5. I can't take because my queen is hanging. And after queen d7, he now played knight to h4. So the goal was to redeploy the knight in four moves to this magical square on e5. The downside of this is that white loses a lot of time. And I could actually exploit this right now by playing the move queen to d5. This is also what has happened in the game. Threatening a check and threatening a2. So basically white is forced to go for the following line, which I had not seen coming in the position after knight e3 when he played knight f5. But he just went knight to f3. So the point is, and that's what we will see in the game, that taking on a2 is possible, but actually white has a very interesting reply against that. By the way, in this position, I could even go for something like rook d6, according to the computer at least. But yeah, I did not really like this because at some point he will land with a knight on e5. Okay, now I have slightly more active pieces and the d-file is mine. But I have the feeling from a human point of view, it's still slightly better for white. Yeah, instead, I decided to take on a2. And now maybe you can pause for a second and try to find the best move for white. And well, the best move is just queen takes e6 check. So I'm threatening mate. So the way of dealing with this is queen e6, because after knight g5, king g6, now this threat becomes lethal. So for that reason, he went for queen e6, takes, and now just knight g5 check, winning back the queen on e6. Black has two options. One is to go to g6 and one is to go to g8. The main problem with king g6 here, which looks like the more active move, is that after knight e6, I can't go rook d7 because of knight f8. So I would probably have to go rook e8, but then something like the simple king d2 is pretty annoying for black. So whenever I go to, let's say, f7, there is another check, and it's just a little bit too passive for my taste. So I think here white definitely has an edge. So for that reason, after knight g5 check, I played the move king g8, which is absolutely the correct move in the position. Now white has two options, taking on e6 with a knight or with a rook, and he chose to take with a rook. If he takes with a knight, then I guess a simple move like rook e8, let's say something like king d2 and knight d5 would be fine. Now note that king d3 runs into knight f4. So I think that would have also led to just an equal endgame. Instead, he took with a rook, attacking a6. And if I go rook d6, then he could maybe just trade and now run for these pawns, and yeah, this could still be slightly unpleasant. Maybe it's actually not too bad, but I have, I think, a little bit more precise move here, which is the move h6, first kicking away this knight. And probably he should even go to f3 at this point, but he went actually to h3, after which it's actually only black who maybe could even play for something, I don't know. So I went for rook d6. And yeah, if white wants absolutely nothing, you could just exchange at this point. And then the game should peter out to a draw. but he went for rook e7. And after knight d5, he realized that white has lost any slight advantage he might have had before, and offered a draw after the move rook to e4. Actually, I now just thought the position is equal, and that's why I accepted the draw. Maybe, according to the computer, black could even play on for a bit with the move king f7, and something like maybe f3, rook e6. But it's hard to imagine that black really has an advantage here. So computer gives something like this with a very tiny edge for black, but I think objectively this should also still be drawn. In any case, I didn't really see this idea of going for the rook exchange, because if he actually exchanges the rooks, the knight endings are slightly unpleasant. So I didn't see that that as being a problem for him. So I just accepted the draw, and was quite happy with the way the game went. So to sum up, I played this opening, which, I mean, objectively is clearly slightly worse for black with this pawn on e6, but I was quite confident throughout the game that I would be able to hold that. And I think it's not more suffering than I have experienced in other lines in the Philidor before, so I was quite fine with going for that. So that was game 3 in Berlin, and I will be back with my analysis of game 4 against David Navarra pretty soon.
When you have stress, play chess. When you fall on your ass, play chess for a real deal, for Christian seed.